Radio Islam International. The world is our community.
In Tirmidhi, an authentic narration, it is mentioned that they lived the king who claimed divinity. They lived the king who claimed divinity. And he had a magician. All of these kings who claimed divinity, I don't understand why they needed a magician, but they always had a magician because they doubted themselves. Even Pharaoh had a magician. And the trouble always started with the jadugar. Now the magician was getting old, so the magician said to him, King, get me a youngster, Laitiki, let me train him. So they found one youngster. And the Laiti went the first day now to train. He was very enthusiastic that I'm going to become now the next magician, the official court magician. But on the way, he found a pious man. And he looked at the pious man. You know, it reminds me of the story of Salman Farsi radiallahu anhu, whose father was a fire worshipper, sent him on an errand, and he found a priest. So he finds a monk, and he ends up with the monk, and what the monk is doing fascinates him. And he comes late to the magician. So, Ikhiyom at Taya Club, why you came late? Anyway, next day he's late again, he gets a double hand, backhander. He says, no, I can't carry on like this because my ears are zinging. So he devises a plan. Whenever he gets late to the magician, he says, no, my mother kept me back. And then when his mother tells him, why are you late? He says, the magician kept me back. But he was spending all the time with the monk. And he became a believer. And he reached such a level that one day when he was going to the magician, a big elephant came on the road and it blocked the path. Now people couldn't move. So he made dua to Allah loudly. He said, Allah, if the monk is on truth and the magician is on falsehood, then let this animal move. And the animal moved. And then he went to the monk and he told him the story. So the man told him, you know what? Now you've reached such a spiritual level that you're even beyond me. And then Allah blessed him. He was able to cure the leper. He was able to cure the sick with the permission of Allah by making dua to Allah. Until one of the ministers of the king, this entire story is in Tirmidhi. And until the king had a minister was blind. So the minister heard about him. So he came to him and told him, look, I'll give you whatever you want. Cure me. So the young boy said, I can't cure you. Only Allah can cure you. I can make dua. So he said, first you must become a Muslim. So the minister became a Muslim. And then he made dua and the minister's eyesight was restored. Now when the minister came to the king asked him, who restored your eyesight? He said, Allah. He said, who's Allah? Because he was claiming divinity. So after torturing the minister took the name of the boy. And after torturing the boy took the name of the monk. So all three of them are lined up in front of the king. And the king says to the monk that renounce your faith. The monk refuses. So he has him cut in half in front of everyone. Then he tells the minister, renounce your faith. He says no. So he has him cut in half. And now he wanted to make a public spectacle. So he tells his soldiers, take this boy to the top of the mountain and ask him to renounce his faith. If he says no, drop him from the mountain. So everyone must see what's the end result of those who don't believe in me. That was the king was saying. So they took the boy to the top of the mountain, but the boy made dua and there was an earthquake. All the soldiers died and he survived. Then they came back and this time the men told him, okay, maybe there's something happening on earth. So take him in a ship to the middle of the sea and drown him. The ship sinked with all the soldiers and the boy swam back. Now the king was puzzled. You know, in Durban, they'll say he was puzzling. So the boy said to him, if you want to kill me, then okay, put me up against a tree and shoot me on my temple. Shoot me on my temple. I'm showing you where to do it. But this was all the plan of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And when they shot the boy and the boy died. Now everyone saw when they tried to kill him, they couldn't. But when the boy told them what to do, it was effective. People accepted Islam in their multitudes. Now remember what I told you the other day. When a dictator starts to panic, that is when his oppression becomes the worst. The king started to panic. So he issued a decree. He said, dig trenches and light fires in those trenches. And whoever has become Muslim, throw them one by one into a burning, blazing fire. Now just imagine for a moment, you are alive and you're being dragged to a fire, right? And the only thing that can save you is if you renounce Islam. And one by one, they are being flung into this fire, but everyone is being steadfast. Until one woman comes and she's got a baby. And now she's looking at a baby and you know the maternal love. But Allah blesses the baby with the ability to speak. And the baby says, my mother, hold steadfast. Jannah is waiting for you on the other side. My mother, hold steadfast. Jannah is waiting for you on the other side. In the time of Umar bin Khattab radiyallahu an, they dug the grave of this boy, and Umar radiyallahu an saw him. His body was still fresh, and his finger was still by the temple where he was pointing and telling them, "Shoot me here." So Allah says, "Qutila ashabul ukhdud." You can be the biggest tyrant, you can be the biggest pharaoh, but like I said the other night, every pharaoh has to meet his Moses. This king, whoever he was, there are different names given in different books of tafsir. It was a young kid who had an aspiration of becoming a magician that became his Moses and became the means of multitudes of people accepting and embracing Islam. We say to Allah in conclusion, Allah, you guided that boy, guide us tonight and keep us steadfast on the Sirat al-Mustaqim. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad.